We are on page 215, I believe. Does that sound right? Hopefully. We'll read like a chapter-ish. So in the last chapter, Arthur got a call that someone was at the garage ready to like move everything. So Groovy Jim gave him a call and was like, please get here ASAP. So we're on 215. This is 43. So he's like running to the garage right now.
Groovy Jim's gonna be like, trick you.
So we're on 215. Everything had been moved. Arthur's heart nearly stopped when he reached the gravel alley and saw what was happening. Mr. Hampton had always said, don't move anything. Everything in his creation had its place. Everything had been perfectly balanced. But Arthur could see that the big corrugated metal door at the front of the garage, the door that had never been opened, was pushed up. Cardboard boxes of unused foil and glass bottles and mirrors sat on the gravel outside, waiting to be hauled away. The fragile pieces of Mr. Hampton's masterpiece had been moved to the sides of the garage. So somebody came, moved everything, like put stuff in boxes, and started to move things out. Where am I? Stop! Arthur tore down the alleyway, his arms flailing wildly in the air as Groovy Jim and another man stepped outside. What are you doing? Arthur's voice was a shriek. He could feel the veins pounding in his forehead. His face felt like it was on fire. Can't you see that this is someone's work of art? He shouted, pointing at the masterpiece. That's heaven. Everything in there is supposed to be heaven. Groovy Jim stepped closer to Arthur. Okay, kiddo, you've got to calm down, he said as he squeezed Arthur's shoulder. I know you're upset about the stuff being moved. It wasn't anybody's fault. I only got here a few minutes ago myself. Just calm down a little. I know we can work this out. I don't want to calm down. Arthur yanked his shoulder out of Groovy Jim's grip. You were supposed to watch the garage, he shouted. All right, well, let's just talk things out over with this guy. I'm sure we can figure something out. Groovy Jim turned toward the other man and introduced Arthur to him. Arthur, this is Tony. He's the landlord who owns the garage. So this is the guy who owns the garage. He's probably not getting, like, payment, so he wants his garage back to, like, sell it to somebody else. So that's why he's moving everything. Where am I? It took a minute for those words to sink in. The guy in front of him owned the garage. Hey, kid, the landlord looked at Arthur uneasily, as if he was afraid he might completely flip out. I didn't mean to upset you. I had no clue what the things in the garage were. I just came here to clean up the place and get it ready for renting out. I didn't know it was some guy's stuff. It's the throne of the third heaven, Arthur shot back. Not some guy's stuff. He probably sounds like a crazy person to this dude. Yeah. The landlord looked like a gangster, greased back dark hair, a thick gold chain around his neck. Fake smile, Arthur didn't believe a word he was saying. Arthur worked on the project with the man who died, Groovy Jim explained. He was kind of second in charge of creating the masterpiece with him. The landlord looked at the two of them like they were lunatics. The thing is made out of junk, right? He said, glancing back at the pieces in the garage as if he wasn't quite sure they were talking about the same thing. First off, it's not junk, Arthur said, his voice rising. It started on an island in World War II, with things from an island. It started with death and war, so now he's, like, really started to care about this art piece, and he's, like, defending it. His voice grew louder and shakier, and he could tell he was on the verge of losing it. Jamming his hands in his pockets, he stared at the gravel under his feet. He had to get a grip. He was the director of special projects for the State of Eternity. Mr. Hampton was counting on him. He couldn't fall apart. Look, the landlord said impatiently, I don't know what the hell the old guy was building here. You say it's supposed to be some masterpiece. I have no idea what's art and what's not. It looks like junk to me, but I'm no judge. You pay the rent and I don't care what you do. You can build whatever crazy stuff you want. The throne of the third heaven, Arthur said again, not stuff. How much? Groovy Jim asked. The landlord crossed his thick arms. Hampton paid 50 a month. But April and May weren't paid up, so I'll need 100 for back rent. After that, it's 50 a month. Arthur's heart sank. $100, and then 50 a month after that? Where would he get that kind of cash? So, like, remember, it's 1963, so 50 bucks is, like, a good chunk of cash.
Where did Mr. Hampton?
True. I don't know.
Definitely
selling junk, I guess? I don't know.
Definitely wrong.
I think he did have a job at one point, but
Probably PetSmart.
I don't think PetSmart was a real. He does something.
Like, maybe he's the plug.
So we're on the top of 218. We're going to finish this chapter. Groovy Jim asked, if I give you 50 right now, would you give us a week or two to figure out what we want to do next, given the circumstances and all? Arthur's eyes darted toward Groovy Jim. He didn't think he had that kind of money. Sure, I'm a reasonable guy, the landlord nodded. For a gangster, Arthur thought. Feeling guilty that he didn't even have a dollar to contribute, Arthur watched as Groovy Jim emptied all the cash from his wallet and gave it to the guy. So Groovy Jim, like, helps him out, pays the first month of it. Then he had to go and clean out the cash register in his shop and the spare change on the counter to finally make it to 50 bucks. Take until the end of May to make up your minds, the man said, shoving the handful of bills and coins into his pants pocket. The end of May was less than 3 weeks away. And I'm sorry again for messing up the guy's work, he added. I'm just a regular guy who rents out buildings. I don't know much about art and culture and stuff like that, okay? Arthur almost believed the guy was sorry. He would have believed it for sure if the guy hadn't taken all of Groovy Jim's money. You'll leave everything alone until the end of May? He asked the landlord, just to be sure. You won't come back? Not unless you burn the place down, kid, the guy joked. Arthur didn't even crack a smile. After the landlord finally left in his rattling truck, Arthur turned to Groovy Jim. He took all your money, he said, feeling sick. Groovy Jim shook his head and laughed. No big deal. It's not the first time somebody's taken all my money. Probably won't be the last time either. Now, let's get heaven put back together. They started rebuilding Mr. Hampton's creation as carefully as they could. The gold throne chair with its big set of shimmering wings was first. Around it, they arranged dozens of intricate tables and pedestals and pillars. Arthur remembered where a lot of the pieces went, and he thought Squeak, being Squeak, would probably remember even more. Luckily, a lot of the bigger pieces had wheels on them, which was something he had never noticed before. Heaven on wheels, Arthur thought. His dad would have loved the idea. Oh, wow, the next one's really short. Might as well read it. All right, I'm going to do this last one, and then we'll get to work on our papers. So this is 220. This is 44. It's literally like a page. Unfortunately, Arthur had no luck asking Officer Billy for help with the landlord. He wasn't sure why he'd bothered. He should have known better. He called the officer when he got home after paying off his sister to keep quiet with a box of Good and Plenty candy he'd been saving. He hoped Officer Billy would still be at work, even though it was just after 5. As usual, she answered on the first ring, but she sounded annoyed by his phone call, especially when he told her how he'd run into the landlord at Mr. Hampton's old garage. And why were you at the garage in the first place? She interrupted. Mr. Hampton's possessions aren't your concern. We've discussed this already. Well, then, whose concern are they? Arthur said. Arthur was surprised by his boldness. Officer Billy sighed loudly. I don't know. I told you these situations take a long time. Family members have to be located. The court might need to get involved. But what if the landlord sells what's in the garage or throws it out? Arthur knew he sounded kind of crazed and desperate. I don't think he cares about Mr. Hampton's things at all. I'm surprised you do, Officer Billy replied. Arthur ignored her and kept going. Could you at least talk to Judge Warner? Maybe there's something he can do to stop the landlord. Even as the words left his mouth, he couldn't believe he was asking for Judge Warner's help, the same judge who would have put him in juvie for months, maybe years, if it had been up to him. But judges could make rulings about things, couldn't they? That's what they did in the movies. Arthur knew he was grasping at straws, but he was out of ideas. I'll look into it. That's all I'm promising, Officer Billy said firmly. I'll be speaking to the judge soon about your probation hours and what we're going to do about them. I'll see what he says. In the meantime, stay out of trouble. Don't take anything that doesn't belong to you. Is that clear? No, nothing was clear to Arthur anymore. So he reaches out to Officer Billy to get some help with keeping the garage, like, in his possession, and helping to, like, allow no one to go in there and take it or, like, clear it out. And she's going to ask the judge if the judge can do anything. All right.